Hey there, I'm Sean C. Davis, and in this video, we're going to write a Node script that will connect to a Notion database, loop through all the pages and all the pages blocks using the Notion API, and it's going to write all of that content to a local JSON file. Let's dive in and write some code. Now, as we typically do, we're going to start by installing some dependencies, and the first is going to be Notion HQ slash client. And if you have another way to manage your environment variables, you can do that. For me, I am going to use .env to make it a little bit easier to add those secret values. And that is actually where I'm going to start. I'm going to create a new file in the root of my project called .env, and I'm going to add my two secret keys. The first is going to be Notion database ID, and the second is going to be Notion API key. Okay, I'm going to fill these two values in off screen and then I'll come right back. And next, let's write the code to retrieve the page content only from the Notion database. I'm going to paste some code in and then we'll take a look through what we're actually doing. Okay, at first we bring in our dependencies. Then we load our .env file into our process.env object. We instantiate a new Notion API client. And then we have this one singular asynchronous function, which we're going to call at the bottom of our script. And basically what it's going to do is it's going to handle everything for us. And so let's kind of take a look at what's happening here. First, we're setting the results object that gets returned from this method called Notion databases query. And we're setting it to a variable called pages. And all we really have to pass here is the ID for the database, and we'll automatically get all the pages back from that database. And then once we have those pages, we define where we're going to cache this content. And this is going to be in the same directory we're in at a file called notion-export.json. And then we're going to write that file. And we're going to take the page data, stringify it, pretty it up a little bit, and then provide us some feedback. Now, before we run this script, let's go pop over to Notion and take a look at what we're actually dealing with. Okay, here's Notion, and I have just two simple pages in a database. Each page has a property called slug, and it has some blocks. This page just has simple paragraph blocks, and this other page has a couple paragraph blocks, and then it has the beginnings of our complex, opinionated callout mapping system. Let's go back and run that script. I'm going to call node index.js again. And what this is doing is it's hitting the Notion API, and then it's going to write that content to notion-export.json. And we can see we get a ton of stuff back, actually. It's a couple hundred lines of content, and we can see that we have an array of objects here. So if I close these, you can see I have two objects in here, and we see we get some information about each of the objects. Now, the one thing is, this is information about the page, but we don't have any content at all for the blocks. This is really just information. It's meta information about this particular page or each of these pages. So next, what we want to do is once we have the page, we want to go retrieve the block content from that page. So back in my script, I'm going to paste in a little bit more code, and then we'll walk through what's actually happening. Now, I committed my changes to Git so we could more clearly see what is going on and what's new. Down here in our import pages function, these are the changed lines. And basically what I'm doing is I'm looping through every page, and then I'm calling this asynchronous function called getBlocks, and I'm passing the page ID to that function. And then what gets returned to me as those blocks is getting set as this children page or as this children property on the page. And then presumably if something's there, that children property will also get written to this JSON file in the output. So let's take a look at this getBlocks function. This is also calling the Notion API. And what it's doing is it's calling this method Notion blocks children list, and we're getting the block ID. Now the catch here, this is a little bit goofy, but a page in Notion is actually just a very specific type of block. So you can still call the same methods through the API because blocks are really just children of pages, which are also technically blocks in their system. And then when we get those blocks returned, we loop through each of the blocks and we call getBlocks again if there happen to be any children. Otherwise, we return. And so we get this built-up nested object and get all the blocks in Notion. So let's run that again. And you'll notice when you run this that this takes significantly more time. Now, previously, when we asked for page content, we just hit the database once, we got the page information, and that was it. Now, with the way you have to retrieve block content from the API, we have to hit the API every single time we want child blocks from some particular block or page. So whereas we hit the API once previously, we just hit it another 10, 20, 30 times or so just to get the block content for these couple pages. I'm not sure how it scales. There are probably different methods for doing it, but we want to just show this as a proof of concept, something that is really small and repeatable. And let's take a look at what we got back. Now, instead of a couple hundred lines, we have more than 1,000 lines, but we have a lot of content. And if you recall back in our script, we attached blocks to this children property, and also children of blocks also gets this children property. So if we search for children in here, we should see, yes, we see 38 instances of that. And then we see we're on a page here. We have blocks below that page, and this one has no children. But if you inspected this, you'll see all kinds of nested content. And now we have all the information we need for both of those pages in Notion. But you can imagine taking this and trying to work with it with website code is just going to be a really gnarly process. Plus, we probably want to do a little bit more work with some of this stuff. Like the code that came in from the code block, it's just plain text. But we probably want to do some syntax highlighting while we're processing all this content so that we don't have to rely on front-end code to do this work for us. In the next video, part four, the final part of this series, we're going to take that content, and we're going to transform it, we're going to compress it so every piece of information that is in that file is usable, easy to parse, easy to understand, and then you can take it and use it with whatever framework you choose to work with. I'll see you there.